Speaker, Surgical Management of Paravalvar Leak by Dr. Jayakumar.
Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, let me thank Suresh Rao and this organizing team for inviting me and giving me a chance to be here and give a talk. The CME is mainly meant for the postgraduates, and I find the postgraduate numbers are on the lesser side anyway. Shivakumar has given a wonderful talk about the interventional management of paravalvular leak. Paravalvular leak is uncommon, but is a rare, it's a serious complication of prosthetic heart valve implantation. Paravalvular leak refers to a situation of an abnormal communication between cardiac chambers adjacent to the prosthetic valve. Majority of the patients with paravalvular leak are asymptomatic and they have a benign clinical course. Yet, but as mentioned earlier, 1 to 5% of the patients have serious clinical consequences which requires treatment. The most common significant complication, that is what you just mentioned, after a surgical valve replacement, either it's a mitral or the aortic mainly, it's mostly related to tissue friability, calcification of the annulus, infection, then comes the surgical techniques like continuous sutures, and least of it, the non-pergeted sutures also can cause the cut-through of the sutures and paravalvular leak. The overall incidence is about 5 to 17%. But clinically relevant requiring repair is only 1 to 5%. 1 to 5% of this 5 to 17%, not all valve replacements. More frequent is seen in the mechanical valves when compared with the bioprosthetic valves. And is more common in the mitral valve than the aortic valve, as it was mentioned earlier by Shivakumar. What are the symptoms of paravalvular leak? The symptoms of maybe are either of heart failure, that is due to a left ventricular, left atrial volume overload, secondary pulmonary artery hypertension, audible murmur, dyspnea, signs of pulmonary artery hypertension, RV dysfunction, and elevated JVP. Whereas the symptoms of hemolytic anemia, especially in smaller defects with high velocity jets due to increased RBC shear stress caused by turbulent flow through defect resulting in mechanical trauma to RBC's fragmentation. They come with fatigue, pallor, jaundice, and hematuria. Diagnosis. Most of the slides, there is an overlapping between mine and Shivakumar, but the echo. For diagnosis and severity assessment, 2D transthoracic echo with Doppler imaging is a choice of imaging as the initial assessment. As for further evaluation, 3D transesophageal echo better than transthoracic echo. There is a higher resolution and sensitivity to mitral valve prosthetic valve leak. Position of the probe allows to get a better picture, and the paravalvular jet is no longer obscured by the prosthetic valve by positioning the echo probe. An intra-op epicardial echo and transthoracic echo is well suited for anterior aortic valve rather than a transesophageal for the aortic valve. The severity of the leak is defined by the same criteria as those used in the quantification of native valvular regurgitation. There are a couple of pictures to show that you can see that leak hole over there. It's all shown by Shivakumar. These are the three 3D echoes and the leak that we are seeing in it, and a few more pictures it is already shown. The lab tests are required only for situations with the patient coming in with hemolysis. There is a reduced hemoglobin level, there is an elevated LDH which goes more than 460 units. There is a reduced haptoglobin less than 50 ml per deciliter and an increased reticulocyte count because of the hemolysis. As mentioned earlier, ECG gated computed tomographic angiography with 3D or 4D reconstruction using volume rendering techniques has become an increasingly utilized tool in paravalvular leak evaluation. And what are the indications for intervention? First and foremost comes the endocarditis, and then hemolysis requiring repeated blood transfusions or leading to severe symptoms. The treatment of option, first of all, medical therapy, that includes iron supplementation, beta blockers, and erythropoietin. As I mentioned earlier, majority of the patients are asymptomatic and have a benign clinical course. So those are the people who may be benefited by the medical management. Then comes the transcatheter closure of prosthetic valve leak when feasible. And surgical closure of the prosthetic valve leak is the gold standard. Surgical repair is reserved for patients in whom percutaneous repair cannot be performed or is contraindicated. The contraindications are active endocarditis, significant dehiscence involving more than 1/4 of the valve ring, associated with dysfunction or instability of the prosthetic valve, we call the rocking valve, and when there is a need for a bypass surgery, CABG, then it can be tackled surgically. Surgery, it is either repair of the leak or re-replacement of the valve. And it depends on the surgical, that whether you are going to repair or replace, depends on the surgical findings. Etiology, condition of the native mitral annulus, location and size of the leak, and surgical exposure. Many techniques have been described, either direct suturing or patch closure. Direct suturing, usually when we do a primary valve replacement and at the, when we're coming off bypass with the transesophageal echo, if we find there is a paravalvular leak, we can go back and do a direct suturing. Whereas in a chronic situation, direct suturing may not be feasible. Then there can be a patch closure or the incorporation of the full thickness autologous tissue or ultimately valve replacement. Failure rates ranging from 12 to 35% is mortality rates that increases with re-intervention. The paravalvular leak recurrence is common because the underlying pathological process remains unchanged. Overall surgical treatment offers improved survival and a reduction of symptoms in patients with severe paravalvular leaks when compared with conservative therapy. Operative mortality ranges from 6% to 13%. As it was mentioned earlier, early postoperative 6% and within 30 days another 6%. So about 12 to 13% of operative mortality is there. The residual paravalvular leak has been reported in 2 to 22% of the patients. And the continued risk of paravalvular leak recurrence is higher in patients who have had multiple previous surgeries. I'd like to present before you a couple of cases which was operated in my institute recently. Mr. K was a 79-year-old man who had a closed mitral valvotomy in 1949. He had a Star Edwards prosthesis done in 1984 and a redo mitral valve replacement by another Star Edwards in 2000, and now he has come with severe paravalvular leak. He presented with worsening dyspnea since November 2016, anemia and renal dysfunction. Echo showed moderate to severe paravalvular MR. And that is a picture of the echo picture. The second picture shows the jet going into the right atrium. We can make it out there. So this is the 3D echo of that particular, this particular patient, where there is a practically it is also a big paravalvular leak, a crescent shaped paravalvular leak. And my cardiologist initially thought of doing a catheter intervention. So he was taken for a device closure of the paravalvular leak. So as I mentioned earlier, this was a crescent shaped paravalvular dehiscence, and they put a PDA device at one corner of the paravalvular dehiscence. Then what happened? The MR became more, because with one PDA device sitting there, the crescent shape opened up. And since, because he is having severe renal dysfunction, they didn't want to go further with more dye and all those things. He was transferred to ICU, he decompensated and went on ventilator. So 79-year-old man with renal dysfunction and decompensated heart on ventilator was referred to me for surgery. In the middle of the night, there was no other go. He was 100% mortality without surgery. So we took him up for surgery. And he had a third replacement. Everything went on well. He was on ventilator for a week. He had a tracheostomy. Finally, we could wean him off the ventilator. It went on for 3 weeks. Unfortunately, he developed a lung sepsis, and a month later, he died of sepsis. So, whatever was done didn't make any. But one thing which I want to specifically highlight is practically bigger paravalvular leak, which may require 3 or 4 devices to close it. And if you put one, you're making a mess of things by doing an intervention. The attempted device closure failed, reduced sternotomy and with empty mitral valve with the 25 chitra was done on 26, and he died almost a month, 3 weeks later. And case number 2, that is another boy, young fellow, 35 years, who had an aortic valve replacement with 20 Medtronic Hall in 2005, along with an open mitral valvotomy. He presented with dyspnea, palpitation and syncope. And this is the leak that we are seeing coming into through the aortic valve into the ventricle. Can I have that seat, angio? Sorry, that angio was not playing. There is a... You can see that aortic root injection opacifying the left ventricle through the paravalvular leak, practically opacifying the wall of left ventricle. For the next one also, that's another you're saying. This is the same patient, another view. So this patient actually didn't go for an intervention. He was directly referred for surgery, and we... The PowerPoint. And this is the operative picture. You can see that forceps, this is the forceps which is going through the paravalvular leak area into the ventricle, and this is the Medtronic Hall valve with the, you can see that stud and the disc over there. And he underwent reduced sternotomy, and he was replaced with the 21 chitra processes along with the mitral valve repair, and he is doing well. Thank you very much.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Amongst the causes of paravalvular leak, I think supra annular placement of the wall, that is non-everting mattress sutures, is officially shown to have 3 times more incidence of paravalvular leak as compared to annular placement of wall. Because in annular placement of wall, you can actually see the annulus approximating with the sewing ring. But supra annular placement is like sitting on a chair with total aesthesia or anesthesia of the gluteal region. You don't know whether you are actually sitting on the annulus. So officially shown to be 3 times more incidence.
Latent bioprosthesis are made for supravalvular implantation. The trifecta, you see the now. So you just cannot do
I'm just making you aware. Because in transannular, you can see the annulus approximating, and here you have to go totally by the feel that you are sitting fully.
So for the aortic position, here are the two biological positions which are just meant for
supra-annular
implantation.
No, I'm just making them aware.
Oval or crescentic leaks. There are 2 dedicated devices. One is called as the Ampler-Zero Vascular Plug 3, which has got a longer dimension and a shorter dimension. It's like 12-5, 14-5, like that. So this will have one dimension will be 14, another will be 5. So we need to size it properly on 3D. And then these devices have got certain platinum markers to tell which is long axis and which is short axis. Because once it goes into the heart, then we will not be knowing which is which side. So there are certain platinum markers on the short axis. So that is one. Second thing is there is an occlutic device which is called as an occlutic paravalvular leak device. This is a rectangular device. And this has got dimensions that even go up to 20 by 10, 20 by 8. Often the short axis dimension will be smaller, maybe 6 or 8. Long axis can even go up to 20, 18. So such device... Such devices actually have made it feasible for some of the types of leaks. Obviously, it doesn't make sense to put in one circular device in a crescentic hole. So, but new devices are coming up, and maybe with, it worsens. Correct. We can understand the geometry will worsen. Actually, it is now what was originally something like a 10 into 2 millimeter is now made
5 into 5.
Exactly. So we are stretching it away from the swing ring. So this is where it needs a lot of orientation of the three-dimensional looks of the parabolic leak and taking decision.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Possible. Actually, Dr. Rajesh was just mentioning if you open and then since the areas are calcified or fibrosed, and so those areas are not going to hold a suture, whether intraoperatively you can put in a device, it's possible. The advantage of a device in a transcatheter lab is that the heart is live, so you are clearly seeing the mobility of the discs, and you will know if the disc's mobility is even minimally impaired. But in an arrested heart, you just go by, you are pushing your forceps of the discs to open position, closed position, and sort of indirectly assessing the mobility, which we don't know after you take away all the retracting sutures and allow the heart to come back to its anatomical position, and then it starts beating. At the time, suppose the disc is not moving well, then whether we'll be prepared to go back on bypass. I'm not aware about such an intraoperative direct visualization, just like an intraoperative pulmonary artery stent that is placed in some of the tetralogies. I'm not aware about whether intraoperatively a surgeon will put in a device and try to take it out.
What's your experience like? What about experience of parabolic in TAVR?
I think your centers has got the largest number. We have not seen it. It's quite common, sir.
No, actually, we
have not been doing TAVI. It is very, very high. While we are talking about 1 to 5% of hemodynamically significant, it's as high between 10 to 20%, and especially with core valves.
My question is,
Yes, possible, sir. Yeah. Fortunately, those leaks will be very small, sir. Even though they create a lot of AR and produce a lot of hemolysis, those leaks are smaller. It is approached by certain sleek devices called AVP2, which goes through 5 French coronary guide catheters. So addressing them is easier, but the regular your prosthetic valves leaks are difficult to address because most of them are very large. Some of them will go to 14, 16. Actually, next month we are having a transmission to Frankfurt from our hospital, and we have kept one guy for that. It's a 16 millimeter leak. It's a massive leak. He's quite sick. Just for the logistic reasons, I'm pushing it off because it will be free if I do it on the day of.
I think we can discuss all these things again later on. Last question, Dr. Tendulkar, you wanted to ask? Okay, fine. So next speaker, Dr. Kaushal Pandey, tricuspid interventions.